Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Tidbit Studio. My name is Tia Skytte-Pedersen, and I'm from MDC. And now it has been 8 weeks without any of our wonderful Tidbit lunch talks, and there has only been reruns for the last 8 weeks. So we are back again, and we really hope that you have enjoyed the summer until now. We have opened the physical events again, so we have had to change the concept of our Tidbits. So we'll be on the live studio 2 times a week, and it will probably be on Tuesdays and Wednesdays, because often we have the events on the Thursdays. But look into our emails, and we will make an update on it. Today's Tidbit is all about digitalizations in the transport business, and it is Lars Dagnæs who is on stage. Lars has more than 44 years of experience in Danish and international transport and logistics, and today he is linked to the Transport Innovation Network, TENV. So this guy, he knows what he's talking about. If you have any questions for Lars, you can ask them in the chat on the right hand, or else you can click the button underneath the screen, ask a question, and you can ask whatever you want to, and we will ask the questions in the end. So nothing more from me. Cheers in apple juice, and I'll pass over the stage to Lars. Enjoy.
Thank you for letting me in and giving this presentation today, and cheers in water. And thank you also for the very good presentation about my experience. I don't think that's that much more to say. So let's go to my slide presentation for today. Is it started there? Okay. The theme for today is digitization in freight transport business, disruption or potential new business opportunities in SMEs. You can see the agenda for my dinner here, lunch, starter, main course, and dessert. Going to the starter, some short and long-term trends. In general, you can say a general framework condition for the transport business is actually globalization, the free trade market, and the internal market in EU. From 92, when the internal market was implemented, until today, the internal freight transport by lorry to and from Denmark has grown by 200%. And it is still growing, of course, not just now, but it has been growing more or less continuously for the last 30 years. Two things has been very important in this growth. First of all, the internationalization of the freight trade, the internationalization of the supply chains, and also you see the free, the common market for the whole transport sector. Due to that, there's also been the regulations, driving rest times, road tools, minimum wage, and so on. Quite a lot of those regulations has been implemented by using IT tools. If we go to the market, first of all, there's been a concentration in the market. It has been in the industry who is the transport buyer, and it has been the transport sector as well. What we see for the moment is that the subcontractors are grouping clusters. It could be the supply chains, but it is also what is actually going on in the transport sector. The big companies, the big road freight companies are grouping their subcontractors in a more or less tight connection to them, leading this cluster. There's a competition between networks, and my assumption will be that this competition will grow in the coming years. Supply chain management has concepts has been developed very much, and supply chain is very much about use of information. It's about, very much about digitization. And it's very much aiming the four R's in the bottom of my presentation: responsiveness, reliability, resilience, and relationship. What we see for the moment is the big companies are using very much IT to develop and to enforce their supply chain concepts. What's happening on the technology level? First of all, we see very much new technologies coming up just now. We see reports from, for instance, research sectors, also from, for instance, DHL, talking about the new technologies. But going back to the basic, the competition is not using advanced technology. It's very much the ability to use new and old technologies, creating value to customers in order to gain competitive advantages. It's very much the way in which you use those technologies. It could be old technologies, but it's very much using this technology in a smart way. New players will come into the market. I won't use examples from the transport sector, but you see what has happened, for instance, in the fast food market, where players like Just Eat has changed the competition rules of competitions. You can see small pitcher companies should not be an area where you would expect a disruption by digitalization, but it's actually what has happened there. At the same time, we see the big traditional player develop their business model aiming new values by using IT, digitalization in every sense. That was very short about the trends. You can see, sum up, digitalization will be very much facilitating the development of the transport market in the coming year. What's actually happening just now in the SMEs, facilitators and barriers? The big picture, as I see it for a moment, is business as usual. Quite a lot of companies are not working for the digitization process for the moment. We see some companies, some small and medium sized, actually developing their supply to that digitization process. In the big picture, is quite slowly, but the company actually doing that are changing their concepts. Some of those are actually gaining good position and using the use of IT to facilitate their growth. In the general picture, you can say, will there be a disruption? My point is, I think it's not a question whether or not there will be a disruption, but the question is more or less from who the market will be disrupted. I'm giving some examples who could be the facilitator in this disruption. First of all, the customers. What we see for the moment are big companies. It's both freight forwarders, but there's also big industries and big food process companies who actually are making solutions able to the subcontractors using apps, where it's a condition you being part of those supply chains that using an app driving for those companies. Another act facilitator could be a truck facilitator, the facilitators of the producer of technology. We see that Volvo and the other producers actually are offering different software solutions to the truck companies when they're using the trucks. One vision could be that Volvo wants to expand this IT to a total turnkey product. So when you're driving and buying a truck, you actually are getting a fully management systems for using the trucks. Other providers could be TomTom, Taco Bell. It could be fleet managers, fleet management systems, ERP systems, the financial systems, economics, and so forth. I don't think it will be for the financial systems. I think more evident. It could be for some of the other players mentioned above. But last and not least, the social medias could also in some areas an influence on this. We see that the whole marketing is very much going to Facebook and some of those other medias for the moment. Going to the small companies, my point, I think for the moment we do not see one size fits for all solutions. It's very, from company to company, it's very different what their focus areas are, where they want to start up there. But often good solutions for quite a lot of companies can be based on systems in the market. It could be used different systems mentioned above, combined with smaller applications. What I see discussing with companies, it's very much also that where the companies are changing, it's not about the solution, it's very much about the mindset in the company. In some companies, it's the young generation who has another mindset against using IT, who are actually implementing those things in new systems. Although you can find solutions today, it's my assumption and my conclusion, there are still some gaps in the market there. We still need some systems really to enforce this development. But at the other hand, I also think that those gaps, they will be closed in the coming years, because providers will see that as market, there's a potential area for business use closing those gaps. What's the perception of digitalization in the companies? If you go to a traditional, normal transport company, you'll first of all see there's quite a lot of those, the owners see a little perspective in the digitalization. They don't believe in better competence, they don't believe in efficiency, and they don't believe in better rate of return. There's a general skepticism about developing implementations. Quite often people are talking about limited success implementations. Actually, I've been visiting different companies that sell. They also tell me that they have bought different systems, but they actually never have been implemented. They never have used those systems. Another thing which also has stunned me talking with different companies are quite a lot of companies, they have older systems, they're not updated. And some of the reasons for having those systems are they some years ago have paid a fee for this system, where they nowadays will have to pay a yearly fee. Maybe they have this system on an older server in the back room. And I think quite often the hidden cost of IT are not known in this company. The hidden cost could be what it's actually cost if the server break down. Do they have a cost for maintaining the server? Do they also have cost for consulting, giving different services against this server? So in general, the general picture is the perception the companies are digitization is not a critical issue, and it's perceived as expensive and cumbersome. What are the barriers in the company? First of all, quite a lot of companies, they have not a clearly defined business model, and due to that, it's also very difficult to digitalize. There's limited focus on innovation in companies, and there's no focus on innovate. There's lack of IT competences at all levels in quite a lot of companies. Of course, it's not a core business. It's not a core competence for those companies. And maybe the biggest barrier is there's a limit in this area, is a limited tradition of knowledge sharing. They're seeing their colleagues as competitors, why learn from each other. And this barrier is actually a very critical barrier in improving the IT system in the companies. And of course, last and not least, companies are not seeing the burning platform. The platform is not visible. What's the role of CEO? Yeah, and every company has a CEO. And you can see this process has to be managed. The CEO, you on the front. It's also a decision not to do anything. It's also a decision to close their eyes. It's also a decision to say, oh, that's not my concern. If the CEO wants to do something, first of all, it's very important for him to define the vision, how to win the battle using IT. Do he has a vision on how to use it? If he don't have a vision, I think it's very difficult to start up. Secondly, is there a burning platform? You can learn it from the, but also it could be right interesting to look outside the transport sector. As for instance, as I mentioned before, the Just Eat in the pizza companies. Could the same things happen in the transport sector? After that, you can say it's very interesting to say where to start. Be a little realistic. Count to one. Only start with something you can overview, where you can assure that you can actually come true. And not at least think it's the whole thing as a learning process. Learn from the first stage, use this learning to next stage, but also from who and how will you learn in this process? Who are you learning from? Is it from your consultant? Is it from your supplier? Or is this actually for college or other partners? The desert. I'd make this question. Has the public innovation system a role in speeding up the digitalization? Based on what I've said before, we have a big issue. We have some barriers. The answer would be obvious. And we have a tradition in Denmark, as in other countries, to use the public innovation system, enforcing the innovation and the competitiveness of companies. So therefore, my question should my answer should be yes. What could it be done? First of all, I think we need business cases. We need inspiration. The people, the companies, the company owners need somehow to see a picture. How could they change the company? Those business cases could be very good for the companies, but it could also be good business cases could also be good for using for developing technologies. Secondly, there's an opportunity in the whole business system in Denmark for support and guidance going to the local business support in your municipality, to the Erhvervshusene, which is a new offer actually open for all companies in Denmark. And of course, you can also go to your transport your own organization. Public funding, developing products, we have a tradition for that. And there's even also in some funding support for individual companies. I'll give you an example of that in my last slides. And last but not least, education should be a very important part of this system. The transport, the road freight transport has actually long tradition for using the education system, but not in the area of IT and not in the area of innovation. Here, we really have an area of improvement. I'll promise to give some examples. The first example is a product which is running for the moment in region of Zealand. It's called Digital Roads to Growth. In this product, there are two possibilities for the companies. They can have a support for having a consulting, making a digital growth plan for the company. They can give support to up to 90,000 Danish kroner. It's before VAT. And there's a possibility to have tailor fixed specific companies, specific education in digitalization for the single company. And using this offer, it's free of charge. There's no cost using this offer. If you want to know more about this product, you can go to this homepage, digitalvækst.dk. And my last case is the National Cluster Organization Transportens Innovationsnetværk. It has been a growing process for a long time, for the last 20-25 years, to develop the cluster organizations in Denmark. Transportens Innovationsnetværk has been working for the last 10 years, and from 21, it will be a part of a new maritime and logistic cluster, marlock.dk. Yes. That was my presentation. You're welcome to give me answers, to give me questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lars. First of all, I'm thinking that for me, I can totally relate to what you're talking about, that it's difficult to roll out IT. And I guess that one of the issues is that the transport business is so big an area. And from my point of view, I can relate to when I was sailing on board the big container vessels, when when we check the lashings and where the containers, they are stacked on board. I'm walking around with 80 pages of paper, and if it's raining, you need to make new copies. And we are still talking about IT solutions and apps, which would make it much easier to walk around on deck, and life would be easier, but there must be some problems with the rolling it out also in the transport business. But Lars, I have actually some questions for you. The first question is, in the title of today's tidbit, you mentioned disruption of business opportunities. And I have not heard your bit on business opportunities. Are there any of those in your opinion?
Actually, from my discussion with different companies, I see quite a lot of good examples from, you see, even small companies using the digitalization for creating business opportunities. One of the obvious is actually in the area where you have a marketing against a wider group using new social medias. There are some very good examples for companies using social medias to marketing and actually having very good results on that. Another case, which I think is very interesting, is when you see transport companies, where it's next generation is on the going into the company. Some of those young people, they have another perception of using, they have another culture of using technology, and they are based on their experience, which is not from the transport sector. It could be from using IT in the school, it could be from gaming, it could be from using apps. They're actually developing and implementing systems where they, first of all, are getting use advantages. In some cases, they are actually implementing systems which are doing that those companies can solve tasks for customers which they couldn't do without this digitization process. So there are very, very many good examples. But unfortunately, quite a lot of companies still see digitization as something which is not relevant for them.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but it is actually quite a pessimistic picture you give of the current level of digitization. And could you possibly expand a little on what your assessment is based on?
You see, first of all, there's actually been some investigation, some research about this area for the last years. There are some research reports from this Southern Danish University, SDU, from two different professors there. The one is Jan Albjørn, who has actually been investigating the success and the attitude against the digitalization. There's also been other research reports, for instance, from Via College in Horsens. So there are research in Denmark actually giving this picture of you see the lack of innovation innovation in this area, and especially in the IT area. And beyond that, I've been visiting or speaking with about 100 companies for the last 2 or 3 years, and the general picture is the same. Quite a lot of companies, they don't see digitization as relevant for their company.
Okay, thank you, Lars. You're talking about gaps in the market, which you have not really covered today, but could you give an idea of what technologies or products are in question here?
First of all, having this picture, what is gap in the market, is also, you see, it's also market information. The people knowing this gap in the market, they will also use that for developing their strategy. So, of course, you'll have to go in deep, have a deep market survey to give the right and very precise big picture of this. But I see some general things about the gap in the market. First of all, quite a lot of systems who are, for the moment, being developed for the transport market are not that easy. They're not intuitive in use. And what we see is that, for instance, using the smartphone, the tablet, is actually that you see the advantages of quite a lot of the system are they are very intuitive in use. Mm. And it's and maybe you in some cases you can see there are some general things in more or less in each company, some of those processes. If those processes could be implemented in some systems who are very intuitive in using, it could be more quick to go into this market.
Yeah.
But it's just some ideas about where the whole of the market could be. I also see some integrations between systems are still lagging, and we might also need solutions where it could be easy even for the smaller companies to use the tablet in the car. Or, yeah.
Sure. Thank you. So in your opinion, what is the most important short-term effort that needs to be made in the public business promotion system?
Of course, it's difficult because actually there has been things being done for the last years. We have support systems like the possibilities for having support for digital. But I think a very, very important things which could be done for the short time is, first of all, having a systematic overview, not about the barriers, but also some of the strategies for implementation. And we also need the good business cases to give the companies an idea where to move and where to act and how to act in this area.
Mm-hmm.
If, of course, those companies are willing to share their information. On the other hand, it could also be a marketing of this company sharing experience.
Okay. Lars, time is running, and it's we have promised that in the Tidbit studio it's only 30 minutes when we are live, so we have 3 minutes more. And I have one last question, actually, in relation to the business promotion. Could it be a solution to let market forces ensure the development of IT in the transport industry, you think?
You can see, first of all, we have a long tradition in Denmark and Europe and the whole world using a business innovation system to enforce the competition of the companies. From my cooperation in other projects, I've actually learned that even in the United States, business promotion systems is a very developed part of the system. So based on that, you see, it's a way for us in Denmark to keep competitiveness in the whole sector is actually also to use the cluster, the whole business promotion system to develop the competitiveness of the companies. But maybe looking at that, it could also be important to make a kind of check of the neighbors, what is actually going on in the other country about us, because if the system is not enforced in this area in Denmark, that could be a threat of the competitiveness of the Danish transport industry compared to the other nations.
Okay, thanks Lars. I guess this was the last question to answer, and it's all from now, from the two libraries. I can see that the rooms that we're sitting in, they look like each other. Thanks to everyone for listening along. And we are back on Thursday, where Nils Wang, he will talk about the Arctic security landscape and all the political rivalry, which is up north and on Greenland. And he will talk about why Trump, he wants to buy Greenland. So sign up for Thursday. I've put a link in the chat, so you can sign up for invitations for upcoming physical events and tidbits. So I hope that you have enjoyed this tidbit, and have a great day. Goodbye from me. And last, we have something in the end to say?
No. If you want any information, don't hesitate to contact me.
Great. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.